that belief. This was an organization, a nonprofit that started 15 years ago in Silicon Valley. It was the height of the dot-com boom, and the dominant paradigm everywhere said that greed is good. More is better. There's no limit to how much you can accumulate. And there was a young group of friends who said, you know, we want to do something different. And so what they started to do was build websites and give them free of charge to nonprofits. Money wasn't the focus. The intention was to practice unconditional generosity. We delivered millions of dollars worth of services, but it was all given as a gift. And everything that we did had to follow our three principles, and none of these principles made any sense to the business world. Our first principle was to stay volunteer-run. We had no paid staff. People looked at that and said, you won't scale. Our second principle was not to fundraise. We wanted to practice serving with whatever we had in the moment. People looked at that and said, you won't sustain. And our third principle was to focus on small acts. Mother Teresa once said, you know, we can do no great acts. We can only do small acts with great love. And that's what we wanted to do. We didn't want to strategize around grand outcomes. We wanted to fill every small action with love. People said we wouldn't have impact. But the truth was, what happened? These three constraints pushed us to discover new forms of value. We scaled, we sustained, and we blossomed into an entire ecosystem of services that now encompasses close to 500,000 members across the world. And along the way, we tried to develop services that were hard to monetize. We live in a world where bad news is easy to sell. That's what drives the fear narrative, the sensationalism that we see in the headlines. But that doesn't spark transformation. So we started a daily good news service. It's called DailyGood. And we started sending inspiring real-life stories to people all over the world. Then we started a website, a repository of uplifting videos. It's like a YouTube for positive things. It's called KarmaTube. Then we said, what else is hard to monetize? Kindness. You can't put a value on it, and yet it keeps the world going. So we created a portal that helps spread small acts of kindness. We started a pay it forward restaurant. We started a whole slew of projects. And in each of these adventures in generosity, we discovered over and over again, generosity is generative. It creates new value. And giftivism organizes that value through four key shifts. The first shift is the shift from consumption to contribution. Humanity is consuming at higher levels than ever before. Since the 1960s, the average household consumption has gone up fourfold. Has our happiness level increased correspondingly? Far from it. The commercials that we're bombarded with want us to believe that if we buy the next new thing, we'll fulfill our dreams. Yet in our hearts, we know that it's not mindless consumption that makes us happy, it's meaningful contribution. Studies have shown that people who give regularly to others, they have lower stress, they experience better health, they live longer, they live more productive lives. But we don't need these fancy studies to tell us that. We know it in our hearts, giving feels good. So we decided to unleash a series of experiments in generosity. We started doing simple things like paying toll for the car behind you at the toll booth, buying coffee for a stranger at a cafe. We had a friend who was traveling business class, spontaneously decided to gift his ticket to an elderly woman traveling economy. Imagine being the recipient of any one of these acts. When you experience that kind of counterculture generosity, it lights up the giver and the receiver. It's a two-way street. Generosity is a win-win game. It's not a zero-sum thing. Then we started smile cards. These are small pocket-sized cards that are an invitation. You can do a kind act and pass the card along. They tell the recipient, someone reached out anonymously to do something kind for you. You can keep that spirit going by doing something kind for someone else and passing the card along. We've shipped out more than 1 million of these cards to 90 different countries. We have a website where people share their stories. It's incredible. Think about a world where everyone's going around like undercover kindness agents. You know, you're looking for that next opportunity to make someone's day, to make someone smile. We're surrounded by those opportunities. And it's not just this fluffy feel-good exercise. When you do these things regularly, consistently, when you make that commitment, it starts to rewire the way our minds work. Instead of opening every door and asking, what can I get from this situation? What can I take? You're asking, what can I give? What can I offer? And when you do that, your actions start to catalyze a rich network of ripples, and you tap into the joy of purpose. A beautiful quote says, the fragrance always remains in the hand that gives the rose. That's what happened with Raghubai. Raghu was born in a village in India, and as a child, he was struck with polio and lost the use of both legs permanently. In his teens, he left home, determined not to be a burden on his family, and he found a job arranging shoes outside a temple. Several years ago, there were two college boys in that city who decided to hit the streets and do random acts of kindness. They had their own smile cards. And they ended up bumping into Raghu outside the temple. And they were so struck by his intelligence, his dignity, and his warmth that they decided to do another act of kindness. And they decided to introduce Raghu to one of their mentors who ran a nonprofit. Raghubai ended up joining the nonprofit. Then he ended up becoming a project manager for one of its divisions. And the story didn't end there. A couple of years after that, as a gesture of gratitude to the people who had helped him, Raghubai decided to start a new project. What did he do? He said, I'm going to give up one meal a day, and I'm going to gift that meal to someone in need in the slums. The word spread. People were so moved, several of them offered to donate a meal as well. A blind woman in the community stepped forward to cook these meals. And it turned out that Raghu then started to deliver dozens of meals, not once, but twice a day, to elderly and abandoned women in the slums. That was the hand-pedaled tricycle he drove. Through the scorching heat, through the pouring rain, he was there to deliver these tiffin boxes. And he didn't just drop them off at the door, no. He went inside, he sat with these people. If they were sad, he made them laugh. If they were sick, he brought them medicines. He touched their feet, he received their blessings. He wasn't just delivering food. He was bringing his love, he was bringing his presence, he was bringing that listening ear. Those things are transformative. It didn't even stop there. Then he started a Tulsi plant project. Tulsi is a kind of basil, it's a variety of basil. It's considered a holy plant in India. Whenever Raghubai discovered a family or an individual that was going through a difficult time in the slums, he would gift them a Tulsi plant to take care of. Then he would visit them the next day and the next day and the next day, supposedly to check on the plant, but really to check on the person. He gifted more than 1,000 plants in his life. Earlier this year, tragically, Raghubai was killed in a road accident. And yet his legacy of love lives on. The week after his passing, a young man showed up at the nonprofit where Raghubai had worked. He too was pedaling a hand-pedaled tricycle. He too was a victim of polio. And he said, I used to work at a call center, but I heard that Raghubai is no more, and I quit my job. I want to deliver the food. I want to make sure his legacy continues. Think about the power of that moment, the electrifying beauty in that. And think about the fact that if you had crossed Raghubai on the streets, perhaps you might have looked at that person and thought, oh, that's someone who really needs society's support. Well, the truth was, this was a person who was supporting the community in incredible ways. When you move from consumption to contribution, you tap into that truth. Everyone, in every condition, in every moment, has something vital to give the world. The next shift is from transaction to trust. A prime example of this, and one of my favorite examples, is Karma Kitchen. This is a restaurant we started in Berkeley, California, 6 years ago. And the unusual thing about it is that there are no prices on the menu. At the end of the meal, all guests receive a check for $0 and a note that says, someone who came before you gifted you this meal. If you'd like to keep the circle of giving going, you can pay forward and make a contribution for someone who comes after you. So when we started this, we had no idea whether we were going to sink or float. It's a little bit of a crazy notion to put out there. And yet what happens? 6 years later, we're going strong. When you create a context for people to practice generosity, when you count on them to be generous, it sparks something deep inside us. That's what happened to Piero. Piero walked in several years ago. Volunteers were serving tables. He walked in. He was a stockily built man. He had a shaved head, several tattoos. He sat alone in a corner with his head down, didn't say a word to anyone, finished his meal, and was out the door. Then, you know, Karma Kitchen, we welcome everyone. And our main job as volunteers is to serve everyone who shows up with love. So we didn't think too much about this. A few hours later, restaurant had closed. We were in the middle of cleanup. The door bursts open, and it's this guy. He walks up to the server who had waited on his table, and he says, "My name is Piero, and I'm here to tell you how much this meal meant to me. I had a very difficult childhood. For years, I lived on the streets. I used to actually come to this restaurant. It was a different restaurant back then, and I would steal food from this place because I was so hungry. And today I was walking by and something drew me in. I had no idea what this place was. And I walked in and I sat at a corner table and I put my head down and I hoped no one would see me crying. Because to be welcomed with such trust, to be served food with such unconditional love at the very same place that I'd stolen from as a boy, that healed something inside me. And now I want to give back." That day, Piero washed dishes at Karma Kitchen. There's something magical that happens when we move from a space of transaction to one of trust. When we move out of that mindset of quid pro quo, we drop into the flow of giftivism. You don't know who paid for the meal that you're eating, and you don't know who will receive the contribution that you make, but you trust in the cycle of the whole. Everything moves and works beyond the control of our personal egos. And when you do that, when you have that kind of trust, you start to build a web of resilience. There are now over half a dozen Karma Kitchens around the world. Last month, one opened in Indonesia. 2 weeks from now, one will open its doors in Malaysia. And this pay it forward spirit isn't something that's just confined to the restaurant world. This is Uday Bhai. He's a rickshaw driver in Ahmedabad. He heard about the Karma Kitchen. It's called Seva Cafe in India. And he said, "I want to do this with my rickshaw." Uday Bhai has a family of five to support. This isn't some casual, happy little thing, side job that he's thinking of doing. He says, "No, I'm all in." When he picks up a passenger and drops them off, he says, there's no meter on his rickshaw. He says, "This was a gift from someone who rode with me before. If you'd like to make a contribution for the next passenger, you can do so." He's been going strong for almost 5 years. That's the power of that kind of trust. The third shift is from isolation to community. Now, when we have that mindset always centered on the me, that limits the impact that we have in the world, and it is very isolating. What happens when we move from me to we? This is Pancho, one of the most fearless giftivists I know. He lives by choice in a community in East Oakland. It's one of the most violent and poor parts of the country. Gangs all over the place. There are more liquor stores than grocery stores. And yet the doors to Pancho's house, Casa de Paz, House of Peace, they're never locked. There's a garden in the back where they grow fruits and vegetables. They run yoga classes for the community, a weekly meditation gathering. Anyone can come. Every weekend, they harvest fruits and vegetables from the neighborhood and they set up a fruit stand, Fruta Gift. They gift organic local produce to families in need. They've created a context where people can come together and share their gifts. People in this neighborhood now, they clean the streets together. They tend each other's gardens. They take care of each other's kids. People, when they heard gunshots in this neighborhood, they used to hide under their beds. They used to lock their doors. Now they run out into the streets and they say, "Who needs help?" When you move from isolation to community, you tap into the power of synergy and you discover that the whole is always greater than the sum of its parts. There's a story about Pancho that I want to share. It's a beautiful one. He was coming home one night late after a meeting by himself, and he was attacked by two gang members. First man punched his face, the other went for his throat. Pancho's first response, he turns to his first attacker, and he says, "Brother, I love you." He turns to his second attacker and he says the same thing. Brother, I love you. And if you're going to hit me again, look me in the eye and do it. You don't have to do this. I wish you no harm. What did these do? It stopped them in their tracks. If Pancho had lashed out at them, they would have known how to respond with more violence. They had no idea what to do with this wave of love. So what did they do? They turned around and started running. What did Pancho do? He started running after them. And so there he is, this skinny guy. He loses one slipper, so he's chasing them in one slipper, saying, wait, wait, don't run, don't continue this kind of pattern. If you get caught, if you go to jail, it's so hard to break the cycle. This is my address. Come see me. I don't lock my doors. Come anytime. Imagine that, and that was his reflex response. This was the middle of the night. He didn't have a script. It wasn't a rehearsed thing. His reflex response was love. When we live in isolation, we respond to life with fear. When we live with a sense of community, when we live in communion, we respond to life in all its forms with love. That's the power of what this little story of Pancho's demonstrates. The fourth shift is from scarcity to abundance. Is the glass half full or is it half empty? It's really not a question of material things, it's a question of mindset. When you come from a mindset of scarcity, nothing is enough. When you come from a mindset of, I have sufficient resources to do what needs to be done in this moment, everything opens up in a different way. You discover new forms of capital, trust capital, synergy capital, social capital. You discover breakthrough models of abundance, which is what happened with this gentleman. It's a deep honor to introduce him to you. This is Dr. Govindappa Venkateswamy, my grandmother's eldest brother. The world in the West knew him as Dr. V. In 1976, he founded an 11-bed eye clinic with his five brothers and sisters in India. It was called Aravind. They decided that they would turn nobody away. They give away 60% of their services for free. Everyone receives high-quality care. They don't do any fundraising or take any donations, and yet they are a fully self-sustaining enterprise. How does it work? Patients choose whether or not they will pay. They can